開會，我首先是歡迎發展局局長和他同事出席這次會議的。這個環節是關於規劃地政方面的開支預算。
Well, let's start it. This part is about planning and work, planning and planning and lands. Chairman, I would like to thank members for the interest in the estimate of the Development Bureau. My respective controlling officers of the Planning and Lands Branch and relevant departments have provided answers to 234 written questions from members, accounting for the use of resources under their purview. We are here to respond to any further questions that member may wish to raise. You're the first to press the button. Have you got any proof? All right, I trust you. Please continue. The 2018-19 recurrent expenditure on planning lands is $5.62 billion, representing an increase of $490 million, or about 9.5% compared with the revised estimate for 2017-18. There will be a net increase of 548 civil service posts in the planning and lands branch and departments under its purview, including 17 civil service posts in replacement of non-civil service contract posts. The establishment of Directorate Civil Service posts will increase by 3. The additional recurrent resources this year are mainly deployed to the following areas. Firstly, to take forward the work of land development. Second, to strengthen the work of safeguarding building safety. Thirdly, to step up enforcement of matters of land administration and planning. Increasing land supply is top priority of the Development Bureau. We continue to adopt multi-pronged approach, create and finance on all fronts, including rezoning, coordinating studies on brownfield sites, and taking forward new development area projects. We give full support to the work of the Task Force on Land Supply. Two studies will be completed this year to provide the basis for policy formulation on development of brownfield sites. During the implementation of development projects, we enhance communication with affected households and stakeholders to make the best effort in explaining and making compensation relocation arrangements. The task force is also working at full steam to make the final preparation for the five-month public engagement exercise, which will commence at the end of this year. Expediting the process of development approval is another key area. In this regard, additional manpower will be deployed to the buildings department to handle the work of building plan approval, while a centralized coordinating section dealing with land supply will be established under the lands department to focus on processing of big ticket lease modification land exchange cases. In addition, there's an interdepartmental steering group will be set up under the PLB of the Development Bureau to study ways to streamline or improve the development approval arrangement. We'll engage the industry during the process, including the special committee comprising representatives of relevant professional bodies and associations to be formed shortly under the auspices of the Land and Development Advisory Committee. We aim to roll out the first batch of streamlined arrangement in the latter half of 2018. Apart from developing additional land, we'll also make optimum use of existing land resources. The Financial Secretary has advised that $1 billion will be set aside to support NGOs to make use of vacant government sites for community purposes, which will include vacant school premises. We'll consult the panel on development in the latter half of 2018 before seeking funding approval from the Finance Committee upon finalization of the specific implementation arrangements. In the meantime, we're also reviewing ways to facilitate revitalization of industrial buildings. Our aim is to come up with the proposed initiative in mid-2018. As for the work of safeguarding building safety, we'll implement the Operation Building by 2.0. We'll step up building department's enforcement actions relating to building and slope safety, enhancing support for building department's other related work. The government plans will also include the enhancement of efficiency of the joint office in handling water seepage cages in the program. The government plans to allocate a sum of $3 billion non-recurrent expenditure for OBB 2.0. Subject to passage of the Appropriation Bill 2018, the government plans to accept application from mid-2018 onwards. In view of the lead time required, the ULA, together with relevant departments and organizations, have already held briefings for first-round target buildings to explain the arrangement. Our aim is to provide the appropriate technical and financial assistance to 2,500 eligible domestic and composite buildings, and rehabilitation work required under the mandatory building inspection scheme in the next 5 years will be covered. Last but not least, both the Lands Department and the Planning Department have been allocated additional manpower to enhance enforcement against illegal use of lands, including step-up patrol at black spots against illegal occupation of government land, and will take resolute enforcement action against offenders. The above is a brief account. My colleagues and I would be happy to take any questions from members. Thank you. Mr. Lau Kofan. I have been asking questions in relation to NE's NT, the land resumption. Land resumption is going to take place in 2018. You are not going to achieve that because of relocation and compensation issues. You can only do this in start to do this. You can only start to do this in 2018. So as a consequence, there will be a severe drop in land supply in 2023. Steady land supply is very important when it comes to the development of new town projects. To do it smoothly, you must make sure that the affected residents will be adequately compensated and relocated. Our compensation system is the most backward, even when compared with the mainland. In other places on the mainland, they will get a compensation at 1.2, 1.3, or even 1.5, the cost of a replacement house. You now want to clear them for the sake of a new project, but you give them just a public rental housing unit without the need to go through the means test and assets test. So it's a one-for-one exchange in this under this arrangement. When can the rehousing and compensation arrangement be devised in such a way that the waiving of means test and asset test will be part of it? Well, the current rehousing arrangement is reasonable in a sense, but we will review the arrangement to see how we can make improvements. In the consultation in relation to the Fanning North project, we have received views covering a few important points. First of all, the cash, whether the cash extraction payment can be adjusted upwards, and whether the compensation package can be more flexible. For example, whether those who cannot pass the asset or means test can also get rehoused. We have seriously considered this. But this is an important matter. The government hasn't made a decision. I cannot really say at this stage whether the relevant criteria will be changed or when they will be changed. I don't want to speculate now. If we are going to change those criteria, we would set out the justifications, and if not, the reasons for that as well. And very quickly, let me also move on to other points raised by Mr. Lau. Yes, we're going to start the land resumption next year. Well, it's later than what we expected. We'll try to catch up in the construction phase for the Tung Chung New Town project. We got the funding approval 6 months later than we expected, but the population data will not be changed much. We'll try to catch up, although we may not be able to fully catch up. But the most important thing is that you should rehouse them before you clear their residences. I want to talk about PL077. This is about shared bicycle operation. You can see that they're everywhere. They're parked everywhere. And the government says the mode of operation is very much like the traditional mode of bicycle hiring. Well, no difference. Please look at the photos. That's a big difference. Well, if something is the falls within the purview of the departments, FEHD, lands, police, and home affairs, all have to play a part, and it means that none of them will be taking up the responsibility. You have got some joint studies. Well, this idea is very attractive. Many countries try to tie in, but then when the plan falls through, then we have to handle the messy aftermath. So perhaps you should just cancel this policy. But I know many people would like to have this kind of policy, which is to them the low carbon economy and green. The government should try to find a wider pavement in some districts, and then you should provide the spaces. For example, 5 or 6 spaces for a bicycle. When the bicycle is parked and the apps detect it, the person is absorbed of the liability. And if it's not, and it's parked illegally, you should punish the company for leasing out, renting out these bicycles. If you want this industry to develop well, the government should not just watch on the sideline. We should have the facilities at street corners. Don't provide a big space, a big parking area for many bicycles, because by if you do that, people will have to walk a long distance after parking their bicycles, and people would just park everywhere. Are you going to talk to the industry? Now, they make use of public areas, and you have to expand resources to clear these abandoned bicycles, and it's difficult to catch the cyclists. So are you going to consider this plan?
感謝田議員的問題，都同田議員分享翻咧，就係我諗喺目前發。
I want to share with members our work in the Development Bureau. If the Transport Department thinks that we should have a cycle path, is the portfolio of the THB, and we would provide the necessary facilities. You know, Hong Kong people live in very crowded dwellings. But in our May reply, we have already said that we have no plan to set up a dedicated authority to manage a shared bicycle business. Well, if you're not going to manage the operations, you might as well cancel the policy. I want to talk about a question of a Hong Kong side for Hong Kong people project. This is meant for Hong Kong people to meet their housing needs. But for Kai Tak One project, I don't know why the lands department has approved some 60% of the units to be resold, and 70% have been granted consent or approval to lease out to other parties. How come so many such units have been given the consent, have been granted consent to resell or to lease? If so many consents have been given, have been granted, isn't the policy distorted already? I would like to get an answer from the Director of Lands. Mr. Kwok, let me say something about policy, and then I would invite my colleague from the Lands Department to talk about the actual implementation.
優先令香港永久性居民呢?
Well, the project allows Hong Kong people priority to buy those units. So there was no restriction imposed on leasing or for reselling. Yes, they can do this. There's no restriction, but they have to sell the unit to another one with Hong Kong ID card.
In terms of the actual execution, approval or vetting is required in order to ascertain this criterion, and that the property can only be resold to a Hong Kong resident. So this is not about discretion. So is this the only criterion when you consider the application, when the Hong Kong Property for Hong Kong People policy was introduced? It was not without controversy. But do you agree that this should not be become a speculative activity? Through this mechanism, property holders can only resell to Hong Kong permanent residents, and again a consent is required for lease. For example, if the rental period is very long, that is 30 or 40 years, the restriction to sell can be circumvened, and the lease cannot last more than 5 years, so the principle is the same. For the actual operational details, I would invite Mr. Chen to supplement. The Lands Department is responsible for implementing the Hong Kong Property for Hong Kong People policy for the two sites with HKPHAP conditions. With the without the written consent of the Lands Department, these properties cannot be resold. When would we grant a consent to sell? We must first ascertain that the buyer is a Hong Kong permanent resident, and as the Secretary said, the HKPHAP policy does not stipulate that the flat or property cannot be subleased. So are all the buyers Hong Kong permanent residents? Any owner who wants to sell their flat must obtain consent from the Lands Department before they sign a sale and purchase agreement, and the Lands D will require the lawyers from both sides to ascertain the identity of the buyer, and the buyer's identity must be confirmed by a statutory declaration. So normally the owner would apply for consent from the Lands Department before they sell. Ms. Tanya Chen. This is a question by Mr. Jeremy Tam. The director said that before the sale, a consent must be required, but when do they have to do it, or how early do they have to do it? The director talked about counsel from both sides. Can I apply for the consent to sell, consent to underlet or license, and consent to mortgage or charge all at the same time? Would there be one-stop service? Director, thank you for the question. On the Lands Department website, we have explained that under the HKPHKP policy, the arrangements for applying for consent to sell, consent to underlet or lease, and consent to mortgage or charge are clearly explained. If an owner intends to sell, the buyer must be a Hong Kong permanent resident. So the purpose of the consents is to ascertain the identity of the buyer. if any owner wants to file an application to the Lands Department, they simply has to fill out a form and we would grant consent on the condition that the buyer must make a statutory declaration by using a specified form, and that person must be a Hong Kong permanent resident. The declaration must be confirmed by a solicitor, and the solicitor must make sure that the buyer fulfills the requirements of HKP-HKP, and a copy of the statutory declaration would be filed with the Lands Department for record. So we would not ask the owners when they intend to sell. Normally, for sellers who intend to sell or under let, they can apply to the Lands Department. So does it mean they have to go to the Lands Registry to file a statutory declaration? Would the information be made available to the public and not just solicitors, as we explained? A consent would only be granted after the buyer makes a statutory declaration, and the solicitor must ascertain the identity of the buyer and that the buyer complies with GKVHAP. We do not require the statutory declaration to be filed with the Lands Registry, but a copy would be kept at the Lands Department. The first requirement is a statutory declaration from the buyer, and number two, the solicitor involved must verify this declaration and confirm the identity of the buyer. I'd like to ask about PL006. This is about the Task Force on Land Supply. They will spend $12 million on public engagement. I wonder if an open tendering has been conducted, and what would be done under the PE exercise. Thank you very much for the question. The task force invited two firms. One firm would take care of the public engagement and prepare pamphlets, while another firm would produce a video. And the hiring of these companies have completed the have gone through a tendering process. Next, Mr. Kenneth Lau, Chairman. Land resources are scarce, and everyone is talking about sourcing land. And the TFLS would have a discussion and territory-wide consultation. And Hong Kong people are very concerned about this issue. For new communities that are car-free, would there would planning parameters such as living density be affected? This proposal was made by a recently retired TD staff, Mr. Leung Chee Wai, at Discovery Bay and Park Island. It is not; they are not completely car-free. They do not expect you to drive. You can reach there by bus, minibus, etc. What Mr. Leung's idea is that the number of flats within the same area can be higher, especially for relatively less accessible areas. As to whether this can be implemented in new areas in the future, there are a number of factors to consider. Let me give an example. Would this lead to a hike in the prices of parking lots in nearby communities? these areas are self-sufficient, such as the same applies for Discovery Bay and Park Island. We need some time to look into this proposal, but I do find this reasonable in a way. We have been talking about certain facilities, and we have the the power grid facilities would be installed, etc. Or the feed-in tariff. As Mr. Wong Kam Seng, the Secretary, said, well, a number of members also came up with suggestions. We are looking into the issue with the Environment Bureau. First, to clarify the regulation. Currently, for certain comfort facilities and for minor works, they do not require approval. Only a report is needed. Can we have greater flexibility in the future? Currently, there are certain restrictions such as height. So we are working with the Environment Bureau from a renewable, the Environment Bureau would think about renewable energy and for us building safety. So once results are available, we would report to the relevant electrical panels. Thank you. Next, Ms. Claudia Mo. Thank you. I'd like to talk about question 181. My question is very simple. Do you intend to rename any streets or places in Hong Kong in order to remove symbols or signs with colonial characteristics? For example, Queen's Road East. And in Kowloon Tong, we have Oxford, Cambridge Road, etc., Durham Road. These are traditional, some traditional colleges in the UK. And you said the government has no plan to systematically rename streets with established names. So I assume that you would not rename any streets. So my understanding is that you would not rename any streets for the sake of removing colonial characteristics, and you said you do not plan to systematically rename streets, so are you going to rename any streets arbitrarily? There used to be a square street or a public square street in Yamate. Well, it used to be called a square street, but now it's called a public square street. So are you going to rename any streets for the sake of facilitating public convenience? In the main reply, we do not see a need to rename streets in Hong Kong, and if streets are to be renamed, lands the would consider potential confusion and inconvenience to local residents, businesses, the public, etc. The colonialization is not one of our consideration. For the arbitrary renaming, do you plan to rename or shorten any long street names? When we think about specific streets, very often the proposal would come from specific members of the public and district councils. Mr. Chen, can you give any examples? I have no such information on hand. I can provide the information after the meeting. When dealing with street names, the lands department would look at actual needs, and new streets would have would need to be named, whereas for existing roads, we receive suggestions from time to time whether the names should be edited or improved, but we would consider the different factors mentioned by the Secretary. In the Secretary's speech, he talked about land supply and available land, but you did not mention the Fanling Golf Course at all. Is the topic too sensitive to mention, or is there a lack of progress? This is on the back burner for a lot of people because it is a significant piece of government land.
Thank you, Ms. Mo, for your question. To the government, developing land is very important, and the task force is going to embark on a 5-month consultation exercise. And one of the issues to consider is the private pressured lease, which is not mentioned in the opening speech because of the need to keep the speech brief.
有内容.
Please project the number on the screen, which will make it convenient. I will ask the Secretariat to explain. No, there's no need to do this. We have to save time. We talk about the number. Well, it's good to have a number. But you have heard it maybe next year. In the past, we did have the reply number. It's good to have the reply number, even if it's just the reply a number, but you are not stating the fact. You said the reply number was given, but the content was never displayed. Please. If you have the number, then I know how to follow up. I can have said that I can consider providing this reply serial number. That's what I want to have. All right, if you say that you will not provide the answer or the reply, you should give us the reply serial number. That would be good enough to make available data in the through a publicly accessible platform, so that private parties can have access. I believe the government is going to do this. At present,
如果大計劃裏面能夠完成到最後咧， 個過程都好長。
It will take a long time to implement this policy direction. We need to open up data. The industry would like to get some of those first. We have made some headway. For example, TFEDM on employment and population. There were some controversies. And that is private organizations could not have access to those.
计划咧，规划咧又不符合咧，就根本就冇得旨意可以获得批准。
But you want when you apply for planning approval and it goes against the government's established guidelines, then the chance of getting approval is very low indeed. We have 400 areas which can be grouped into different major zones. The industry find this arrangement difficult to use. So I want the Secretary to further open up such data to the public. On the sharing of space data, or CSDI, we have a policy to open up as far as we can. And in the middle of 2018, there will be a further platform. A lot of information is kept by the Lands Department. And some information are with the Planning Department. Well, they have to consider that if the information is provided to a very small area, about an area, a very small area, then there's a confidential issue of confidentiality. And sometimes they do not provide a very detailed breakdowns. If the industry would like to make such suggestions, we are willing to consider such suggestions without breaching or violating government policy considerations. Well, we have to be realistic, and I don't think the government is against private parties that are taking forward private projects. But we want to tie in with government efforts in taking forward development projects. Let's do more in deregulation and taking down of barriers. Please take into consideration the actual needs of the industry. Next, Dr. Kwok Ah Kay. It's a reply number 215. Yesterday, when we talked about housing secretary, hundreds of thousands of people in Hong Kong are waiting for more land site to be identified by you. And he said the task force on land supply, chaired by Mr. Wong Yun Fai, have come up with suggestions in the immediate to distant future. Most sites are owned by the government. Reserve for village type housing, how much land is reserved for this purpose. In agricultural zones, hundreds, according to the latest information. There's another one at Shantin, Yan Sao Wai, and Tong Sao Wai. Next to the shopping facility. This is the what it looked like in the past. It's the river, 50,000 square feet was reclaimed, and now this is a site, construction site. You can build 50 to 70 small houses there at a cost of at a value of 1.4 billion dollars. So the government tolerates the destruction of agricultural land on brownfield sites, and now even filling up the river channel is allowed. Are you saying that you can allow or you encourage people to build small houses by filling up river channels? And at the same time, you ignore the welfare of people who have to wait for public rental housing for up to for at least of 4.7 years. It's difficult to respond to a single individual case. But I think the DSD is aware of this. If we look at this year's budget, we have devoted more resources to enhancing the capacity to enforce land-related legislation. In the NT, it said that some people would destruct those sites before they apply for development. For example, they fell the tree or burn the grass, and then they would tell the town planning board that the land has been damage, and town planning board should turn the sites into the V-zone sites. I was The chairman of the town planning board, I would say that this will not be accepted. This is not going to be accepted by the town planning board for rezoning. Dr. Kwok says we hold many land sites. Yes, in the rezones, we have a lot of sites, but there are also many other privately owned rezone sites. So that's what we can see. 50 square feet of water surface now reclaimed as a land, as a site. And the government is saying that you can do nothing about this. How can you safeguard public interest if you allow this to go ahead? This is a real case. Go to Sun Tin with me if you want. In the rural area, something is done to damage the environment, we'll be saddened. We have done a lot to ensure the protection of the natural environment. But it's a cat and mouse situation. Our current law enforcement arrangements are restricted in some way. For example, if there's no the development permission area before the formulation of the OCP, then the planning department has no power to enforce the rules. Let's say if there's an agricultural site, if something is stored there, if provided that the height is not exceeding a certain limit, then there's no non-compliance of the law. So we cannot really take action, but we still endeavor to do the best in enforcing the, such laws. Mr. Choi Dick, it's number 11, a reply serial number 11. Today, through some briefing, the government has asked some media to tell us that there will be a gap, a sudden drop in land supply. Now the latest HOS has attracted many more times of application than the number of units. It said that in 2018-2019 there will be 13 sites for private residential development with a total area of 27 hectares. Mr. Si Wing Cheng, the boss of Centralized Property Agency, said that although property prices are high, but we don't have to let everyone to become property owners. We only need 20,000 high-income earners to take up all the flats available. And we have already got 2.5 million France. So according to Mr. C, well, you'd make 20,000 flats available and many high income earners, including new arrivals, new Hong Kong citizens, can take up all those flats. If you say that the green formed GFS scheme would not affect Hong Kong people. And I would like to ask the Secretary to convert these 13 sites, 27 hectares, to be used for the public housing program. At least turn them into HOS developments.
80% 是符合
then the supply will not be lower than the original plan. For the 80% of Hong Kong people who would not otherwise be able to afford a private housing, would be benefited. What are the downside of doing this? If we make these sites available for 80% of those people, Secretary, let's look at the policy intent in land allocation. Let's look at the long-term housing strategy for the next 10 years. It's at the 60% public housing, 40% private housing. We understand there is this surprise tight for public housing. We have made some adjustments so that more sites have been made available for public housing programs in the past 2 years. Of the sites to be put on the land sale program, we have provided 11,000 flats. Then 18,000 have been converted from private to public housing programs. We are talking about 310 flats, which means that we have exceeded the 60% ratio. Starting from 2013, 2014, we started the planning, and then by the time we have the flats available, there's a time lag in between.
Chairman, I'd like to add something. Let's not talk about the long-term situation. You told the media that there would be a gap or fall-off in supply. So the problem mainly arises from public housing rather than private housing. So why are you granting 27 hectares of land for housing development? First of all, I did not leak any such news. I must clarify this. Now back to the fundamentals. In terms of the potential land supply, we have never said that all the potential land supply can be would be sold. When you look at the ratio this year, for example, some projects like One Kai Tak are still in progress. If you assume that every piece of land can be used for high-density public housing development, it is not right. When you look at our land sale program, some sites are in Lantau South. The development density is less than 0.5. In terms of planning, some sites are more suitable for public housing, some for private housing, and there are many considerations. For Kudong North and Fanling North, after accounting for the infrastructure constraints, we can accommodate an extra about 11,000 flats, and they are fully reserved for public housing. And there were doubts from the community that this would turn Kutong North or Fanling North into sad neighborhoods. Mr. Chu, please wait for the next round. Mr. Frankie Yek, thank you. I'd like to ask about reply number 234 about the Hongshoukyo new development area and the brownfield operators within. Later, the government would resume the land and there would be a compensation policy. At an earlier panel meeting, we discussed the issue, and one of the criteria is that the operators must be operating for at least 10 years before they can or they are eligible for compensation from the government. If you require in situ operation for 10 years, a lot of people might not be eligible. And many operators have been operating in this same spot or in the same district for 10 years, but they might have relocated their operation due to expansion, so they might not be at that location for 10 years. But if you consider operation within the same district, many have been here for more than 10 years. So I think the arrangement is not reasonable. Would you change the criterion into operating in the same district for 10 years instead? You will apply for funding from the finance committee later, but I do not know when. After you complete the feasibility study on multi-story buildings, you hope that affected brownfield operators can be accommodated before, they should be accommodated before you proceed with the land resumption, or else it would affect our economy. Before I answer these questions, I have a point to make. For Hongshoukyo, We are talking about 190 hectares of brownfield sites. Can we accommodate every one of the operators? We can say that it's not possible. Brownfield sites and logistics sites account for about 60 hectares. In other words, we can accommodate about a third of the operations. We must consider our allocation mechanism carefully, because if these sites continue to be used for logistics operations, the land efficiency should be higher, whereas currently the efficiency for certain brownfield operations is very low and they are scattered. Earlier, Frankie Yik arranged a meeting with the Development Bureau together with different stakeholders in terms of the repositioning and compensation arrangements. Till the government has concrete plans, I would not disclose any details, and I cannot provide a timeline at this point. I'm happy to know that you are yet to make a decision. Now, it's all about fairness. I think the criterion should be changed from in-situ operation to operation within the same district. Operators should not be disqualified because they move to another location within the same district. I'm not saying that 192 hectares of space would be given in the future, because some operations would be relocated to multi-story buildings. But as we said, if certain operations cannot be reaccommodated, the trade does not mind being located somewhere else. The key is they can continue to operate. So I hope you can consider these factors before you make your decision. Mr. Vincent Chang, I have two questions for the government. First, about number 038. And about the Yao Chin Mong plan. In May, the government said that they would look into the Yao Chin Mong district study to see. I'm not happy that the demand-led scheme was terminated, so I'd like to know about the progress of the Yao Mong district study. Are there any have any sites been identified? As for the Operation Building Bright 2.0, we welcome the idea, but as I have said before, we have many buildings aged 30 or above, and they need to be maintained. If they are not included under OBB 2.0, it is not fair. The government might say that there are a lot of such buildings and they would deal with the older buildings first. Would you consider an interim review, or once phase one begins in June and July, if not many buildings need to be fixed, would you consider including more buildings? Thank you very much. As for the Urban Renewal Authority study, it was completed, and by end 2019, results should be available. So at this point, we have not identified any specific buildings. As for the URA program or the OBB 2.0 or the demand-led scheme, it is suspended but not terminated because the efficiency was very low. The funds invested were substantial while the number of beneficiaries remained low. As for OBB 2.0, I'd like to thank Mr. Chang for your support in principle. Every year, we would work on about 500 buildings under a risk-based approach. The first batch would be buildings aged 50 or above. So that is where we drew the line. And after we, 1 or 2 years after we began the operation, if we can deal with buildings age 30 or above, we would do something. and we are willing to review the operation. As we have explained to the reference electrical panel, there is a limit to our energy or efforts, and there were calls that we should work on more buildings, but from our experience, the costs would be driven up. That's why we set a target of 500 buildings every year, based on our experience with OBB 1.0. I have a follow-up question. I think this is a chicken and egg problem. I do not agree that the demand-led scheme has not been effective. At least you can give people hope under the scheme. For the Yao Mong district study, I think the progress is rather slow, so I think you should speed up your work. As for the OBB 2.0, we indeed have a lot of buildings 30 years old or above, and they need to be maintained urgently. So hopefully the government can relax the criteria. Mr. Jeremy Tam. Question number 191 about Hong Kong land for Hong Kong people, or Hong Kong property for Hong Kong people. The government talked about policy intent, so I'd like to talk about the intent of the HKPHAP policy. In Mr. CY Leung's election manifesto, he talked about the provision of government land for the middle class. And in January 2013, for a paper submitted by Transport and Housing Bureau on enhancing the housing policy and tackling housing demand, he said that the HAP policy would give priority to the housing needs of Hong Kong people. So these are the policy intents. And when the policy was announced, there were different constraints, and that is properties can only be resold to other Hong Kong people, and lease agreements cannot be more than 5 years. And these were reflected in the selling prices. They were slightly cheaper than other properties. Or for One Kai Tak, the average price was more than $20,000 per feet, which was comparable to other properties in the Kai Tak development. So ultimately, the developers were the ones who benefited. And we had 700 to 800 cases or applications for sale or underlets. So where is the policy intent? The buying prices were the same as other properties in the area, and once they apply for consent, you would grant it immediately, so long as they declare that they would sell their property to a Hong Kong person, it would be granted. So these are already clear in the land or the leases, and if a seller wants to sell, the solicitor would tell them that they can only sell to a Hong Kong permanent resident. So all these constraints are clearly explained. So what is the consent for? Are you saying that so long as they are willing to fill out a form, they would be given consent? The Hong Kong Property for Hong Kong People policy is a complete failure. And the intent was to sell properties to users, but now it's no longer the case. Half of them are leasing out the property. So how can you not call this policy a total failure? Are you still fulfilling your policy intent? Thank you very much. If Mr. Tam has criticisms of the HKPHAP policy, I can understand that. But when you talk about policy intent, you should think about the design of the policy. for the when the measure was announced in 2012, there were no constraints on resale or letting out of property to Hong Kong people or Hong Kong permanent residents, and a property under HKPHKP can only be resold to a fellow Hong Kong permanent resident. So the policy was not a failure. Many Hong Kong permanent residents who bought properties in Wan Kai Tak did not intend to live there themselves. They intended to let out or sell their properties eventually.
In so doing, they are not violating any requirements or conditions. So you wanted these people to buy those properties to let, so that they can let the properties or to sell the properties? This is speculation. Is that what you want? When the policy was formulated, we made it clear that the relevant properties could only be sold to the other Hong Kong permanent residents. They can also let the properties to Hong Kong permanent residents, and if they are to be let to non-permanent residents, the lease would not be will not exceed a certain limit. And additionally, we have no more sites under the Hong Kong property for Hong Kong people sites. I want to ask a question about reply serial number 175. We know in the NT, there are many squatter, and also in the urban area. In the NT, in recent years, in some villages, on land which has no squatter register, have been found to be occupied by squatters. It's said that you have inspected almost 200,000 times for the squatter structures. Do you have any breakdowns on where they are located? Thank you, Mr. Leung. I'll ask Mr. Chen Chongqing, the director of lands, to reply. In our reply, we mentioned the inspections to the register, the squatter structures, to see if they are still in compliance with our relevant conditions. The member is referring to the structures erected on agricultural land which may not be in compliance with the lease. We have stepped up our enforcement action. If we discover such structures, we will take immediate action. In 2017, about 761 illegal structures were found on agricultural land within the same year. We have taken action in 1,190 cases. Some were carried forward from previous years. So that's why there are different figures for the same year. Among the 1,190 cases, 352 cases have resulted in demolition of structures by the landowner, and 700 or so cases have resulted in demolition on the part of the lands department. We'll continue to tackle these cases. For serious cases, we'll try to just stop the population intake. For existing squatters, they may expand the scale or go higher. Are you going to take action against these structures? Well, they may have a red mark painted on the wall, but there are many people. But they are now regarded as squatter structures. Then the housing department and the social welfare department will be put under tremendous pressure. I have handled some cases personally. Can you ask for modification or ratification so that they can continue to use the structures instead of asking those people to move out? Director, can you say something about the enforcement action? Thank you for your question. On private agricultural land, and if there's any newly constructed squatter structure, the Lands Department adopts a zero tolerance policy. It will not tolerate any new squatter structure for accommodation to be erected on private agricultural land. The member is also talking about squatter structures that were registered in the past, and now they have been modified, which make them incompatible with our squatter control policy. In the past, we adopted a more lenient approach. We would ask the occupier to rectify the situation. But I hope members will understand that a few years ago, we had to handle some cases in Tai Tam Tong and Pui Chun in response to public concerns and concerns expressed by members. And that is to say, after the 22nd of June 2012, if there has been any addition or unauthorized alteration or repair or the adding structures on top of registered structures, will not allow the structures to stand. But before that, we would allow the occupier a chance to rectify any structure put there. It's a 204. There will be five permanent posts created in the planning department to oversee the planning and engineering study for the Ma Liu Sui and Long Ku Tan Reclamation. I want to talk about Ma Liu Sui Reclamation. The studies, the engineering studies to be carried out by the CEDD. Ma Liu Sui Reclamation is a controversial subject. It's still controversial. In the public capital works reserve fund, because Ma Liu Sui Reclamation is involved. And the concern is that if we give the green light for this CWRF, it will be taken that we support Ma Liu Sui Reclamation. So that's why it's controversial. The study has been completed. I've given this brief report from the CEDD. Just a side issue. I would like to these reports to be made available to the public with a Chinese version as well. So the study has been conducted, and even before the study was done, I already knew that the conclusion would be that it is feasible. But will you do it, although it's feasible? It said that you would consult the local residents and stakeholders to chart the future direction for development. And now you're going to create some permanent posts to conduct the planning studies. So does it mean that you are definitely going to do it? Are you going to change the OZP so the reclamation will be allowed under the charting OZP? I think the government should first of all consult local people. You should conduct some surveys, opinion survey. before you take the next step in planning. How many of the five permanent posts will be created to oversee the planning for the Amalusoy reclamation? And what is the annual salary involved? Because when we want to move amendments, we need to get detailed information of this nature in different reclamation projects, especially in projects, in respect of projects, they may affect local people. We would do consultation. The government would do this. For Maliusui and Monshan, local residents have views about reclamation. This is understandable. We will do more in disseminating factual information. We are not trying to rush this through or impose this on the district. We need to carry out the studies to gather the relevant data. One of the concerns that we've heard is traffic, whether there will be traffic congestion resulting from this. If we don't have the data, then we'll be talking at cross-purpose. Ask the Director of Planning to say more. For this project, we are given five newly created posts, three professionals and two supporting staff. They would make preparations to embark on the overall planning and engineering study, covering not just Maliusui but also Lung Kwu Tan. So the same team will be responsible for the two projects? Yes. The staff cost is about $3.5 million. In paragraph 6 of the speech of the secretary, he said that $1 billion will be set aside to support NGOs to make use of vacant government sites. I appreciate that. On 022, reply serial number 022, I've asked a question about the land allocated by the lands department. Can you tell us how you assess the applicants? And also how much time is needed from the time of a submission of application to approval? When NGO apply for rezoning, they have to get the help of professionals such as engineers and surveyors, and then the studies will be conducted before a rezoning application can be considered. Since there will be the $1 billion to support NGOs, can you convene the interdepartmental meetings to provide professional input to NGOs so the NGOs don't have to engage surveyors and engineers on their own? Second is about 013. In the policy address, the CEC announced that that industrial buildings may be allowed to be converted into the temporary housing, but it said that there's no government policy on interim housing. The government would facilitate such projects by NGOs. You would be the facilitator. It seems that you are shifting your responsibility to NGOs such as Hong Kong CSS. How are you going to facilitate these projects? Is it that you are trying to pass the responsibility to other parties? Can you amend buildings department so that industrial building can be used for housing? Another question is about 078. This is the Yao Mong district study, and Mr. Winston Chang said this is a delaying tactic. He said that before the study is completed, the government is not going to review the urban renewal strategy. One of the factors under the URS is to do planning with the community, and it should be people oriented. And under the demand-led projects, you have set up teams to serve the people. But you are not people-oriented, and you are not doing planning with the community under those projects because you impose the project on those affected. So if you do not review the urban renewal strategy, the same problems will recur. And I would say that this is just a delaying tactic. Thank you for your questions, Mr. Siu. And I thank Mr. Siu for showing his support to the support measures to NGOs to make use of vacant sites.
The Yau Mong district study is not an obstacle for the government and for the there was no delaying because of that. For Yau Chin Mong, there are 3,000 plus old buildings, of which 800 do not have any would not achieve extra GFA by rebuilding. If we only work on these 800 odd buildings, they would have to they would make a loss of $138 billion. So working on the buildings one by one might not be able to attack the solve the issues. I think the Yau Mong district study would give us a basis to see how we can proceed with urban renewal. So the study is necessary. As for transitional housing, for people who want to provide transitional housing through industrial buildings, of course, a people-led approach was promoted by the government, and the Transport and Housing Bureau would strive to come up with more housing through the Housing Society and Housing Authority, and we still hope that the people can take the lead. We only have about 10 minutes left. Please be brief, or else other questions cannot ask their questions. I will provide a written answer. Mr. Wilson, I have a few questions. First, question 107, as you know, the for the dangerous structure removal notices, they are to do with dangerous signboards. But the removal of these dangerous signboards is extremely slow, and these signboards are still in place for 1 to 3 years. And if they fall, we do not know who would be responsible. In the dangerous structure removal notices or DSRNs, can you speed up the processing speed? We certainly don't want to see any of them fall down. For question number 114, the question number 3474, and this is about the water seepage, the joint office, and they have been criticized of being very inefficient. You often talk about consultancy studies, but at the end, the efficiency of the work remains very low. So how can you speed up the work of the joint office in tackling water seepage cases? So how would you deal with them? For the dangerous signboards, these signboards are everywhere. So how can you tackle the issue? If they fall down, the public would be hurt. And the ULA is developing a lot of sites for the Kuntong redevelopment. The site is prime. Would the sites be returned to the government for public housing or subsidized housing, so that the hundreds of thousands of people on the waiting list can benefit. We are talking about tackling housing shortage. Would you consider speeding up the rezoning process or streamlining it so that more sites can be made available? Satri, thank you very much for the question. As for rezoning, we try to speed up the work, but we face certain constraints for a serious rezoning exercise. We must allow affected persons to express their views to the town planning board. And a study on the consequences of rezoning is needed. So currently, rezoning would take from 11 months to 17 months or beyond. It is not difficult. It is not easy to shorten this process. The ULA does not have a lot of land. Since it was set up over the last 16 or 17 years, they worked on about 9,000 flats or about 600 per year on average. So I wouldn't call this a very big number. Can we further expand the role of the ULA going forward? And after the Yao Chimong study is completed, we would revisit the issue. As for the joint office, after it was set up, before the water seepage joint office was set up, in 14 of the cases, the source of water seepage was identified, but after the office was set up, the figure rose to 40%. But we are looking at difficulties in entering premises, etc. The FEHD and Buildings Department would carry out a joint review to see how we can better improve our workflow. As for the dangerous signboards, I would offer a written response afterwards. I'm a non-executive director of the ULA. A number of members asked about the Yao Mong consultancy study or district study. It is not that we need to conduct a study because the pace of urban renewal is slow. A study would take time. Money is secondary because the government would certainly pay the ULA if they are losing money. So the ULA does not have to think about money. But for a major redevelopment like this, would all the residents be removed from the urban areas? How can we rehouse those living in old areas? And do all old buildings have to be removed? If so, a lot of buildings would have to be gone. So how can we improve the housing so that the living quality of the residents can be safeguarded and that they would not be forced to move into expensive properties because of redevelopment? I hope the secretary can meet our head and give us a written reply, or else the public would have the impression or would have a bad impression of the ULA. Actually, the ULA wants residents to stay in their original area rather than to remove them. I think the secretary should invite the head to clarify the work of ULA. I have a few questions. A few days ago, I asked the same question of the Secretary for Transport and Housing. I asked whether ULA could work with the HA or HS on housing sites, and they said the ULA is under the ambit of the Secretary for Development, so can the ULA work with the HA or HS to develop public housing? I understand that we do not have a number of flats, but we will have more going forward. But regardless, the site would be enough for subsidized public housing, so would the government support this proposal? Under the current tendering scheme, any ULA housing in the future due to the open tendering approach, the cost would be very high, and the grassroots cannot afford to live in urban areas. The only solution is to develop public housing. If you want to speed up urban renewal, the acquisition of land from the ULA to be granted to developers, this is a very long process because developers have no intention to acquire in land for themselves, and they would wait to for ULA sites. So would the government work with the ULA work with the HA and HS to develop public housing? For question 100, the secretary did not answer my question about the so-called capsule homes. And if you do not pay attention to this mode of accommodation, in case of fire or other incidents, safety of residents would be compromised. So hopefully you can address this question. Thank you very much, Ms. Mack. I would be very brief. I'm happy to work with the head of the ULA to clarify the background of the Yashimong district study. As for the second question or comment, I cannot give a concrete answer at this point. When the Yashimong district study is completed, we would revisit the role and function of the ULA. I would not close the door at this point, but I would not say that they have a major role to play in public housing. Historically speaking, the HA and HS are responsible for public housing. The ULA is responsible for acquiring and releasing land in the private market. I'm sure Ms. Mack would know about this. And a lot of new housing estates are in the new territories, and the flats acquired by the ULA are located in urban areas. So this is something we would cover when we review our overall policy. Ms. Mack might know that the ULA is discussing certain cooperation with the Housing Society. They are discussing a potential cooperation in that some flats would be given, or a number of units would be given to the Housing Society. For the capsule-like accommodation, we would provide a written response. The session must end by 5:40, and three members are willing to speak: Ms. Al Lok-hin, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, and Mr. Tong Li-che. Ms. Al Lok-hin, Chairman, I have two comments and one question. Having followed the conversation, as some district personnel, we find it very hard to come to speed with the policies. In question 218 on the public-private housing ratio, like Mr. Chu said, if your goal is to build more public housing, why are some sites used for private development? For the Southern District, for the Leitong South Industrial Area, it's used for private development. It is a urban site. It can be developed for public housing, and there's a need, but it's not being done. In your reply, you talked about the Hong Kong 2030 plus, and you said the departments are 66 hectares short. So if you are short of land for the Carolyn Hill Road site, and you're building a court as well as commercial facilities, and in the Sun District, we need a complex. You want to accommodate certain facilities in government premises, but you're not realizing that through your policy. So that is just a comment. for question 223, you talked about the Hong Kong 2030 Plus study. You would need a holistic plan before we can come up with a proper decision. Earlier, Leshko discussed the Route 11 for Hong Kong Island residents. Even though the government has been talking about Route 11 and the and that is irrelevant to the connectivity between Hong Kong Island and Kau Yee Chau, but according to your earlier report, that is your intention. So can you come up with a holistic transport study? You should not act like you are planning a route and people would see something else in another report. So the planning is scattered, and apparently you are paving the way for big elephant or white elephant projects. So you should have holistic plan. And for Hong Kong Island, do we have to pass by Kau Yee Chau? This is about the fourth cross harbor tunnel. So without such discussion, is that the only point of entry? If we do not discuss that, we cannot come up with a solution.
即係你喺回答啲問題時候，或者喺未來啲顧問研究上面，其實應該係要
So in this consultancy study and further studies, you should take this particular perspective on board. And also 231 is a study on the wholesale market. In respect of Cheung Sha Wan wholesale market, whether it should be relocated, is that there's going to be a study. When it will be done? When are we going to have details? Please be succinct in your reply, Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Ngao. Mr. Ngao has pointed out that there are different aspirations for land use. For example, residential sites, that there's a shortage. There's a shortage of residential site for grade A commercial building sites and so on and so forth. And of course, we're going to tie in with the STB at THB in the study concern. I would refer your views to Mr. Frank Chan. As for the Kau Yee Chau, I'll ask Ms. Ho, Deputy Secretary, to respond. On the wholesale market study, we believe in the second quarter this year we can start the study. It will take about 2 years. Mr. Tony Chair, thank you, Chairman. I want to follow up a number of replies. First one, 002, reply serial number 002. I welcome the setting up of the steering group to the streamline the process. The industry has make a number of suggestions. Let's hope that after the procedure is streamlined, we can have more supply. We can increase the supply. As for the steering group, I'm glad to learn that streamlined procedure will be launched in the second half of this year, and there will be no review of departmental procedures to speed things up. And sometimes the procedure will involve more than one bureau. So please also look into this. Or are you going to look into this? Secretary, thank you for your question. I appreciate your support for the direction we're going to take so as to increase land supply. In some of the relevant procedures, processes. More than one department under the Development Bureau will be involved, but they may have different processes involved. Ms. Benedict Ling, the Permanent Secretary of my Bureau, will be the head of this steering group. And also, can we also involve the Fire Services Department, which is not under the purview of the Development Bureau? We'd like to, first of all, involve the three departments to work things out first. We won't wait until we can implement all of them. We'll implement some of them if they are ready to be launched. And if there's an opportunity to talk to other government departments, we are more than willing to do it. I hope the Secretary will not ignore the issue of matters that would straddle the portfolios of different departments, such as environmental protection and fire services. Please look into those. Second, serial repair number 009 for the next 6 years, you are going to spend $3 billion for OBB 2.0. And it said that you are going to provide technical and financial support to eligible owners. Which department will be responsible for providing the technical support? There are two groups of target buildings. One, those who have owners' corporation, and the ULA will be the agency to help them. ULA would shoulder the administrative cost and will not incur anything out of the $3 billion. For buildings without owners' corporation or cannot form their owners' corporation, then they would involve the director of buildings to carry out necessary building maintenance works by invoking statutory powers of the director. Mr. Wu Chi-wai, in the NT, many agricultural sites have been turned into brownfield sites. When the government announces that certain agricultural sites will be zoned CA, conservation area, or the, some other zonings, and then the sites will no longer be developed in any way. And in the process, no compensation is paid to the landowner. So the landowner would think that if I keep the land well, and I do not damage it, the land may be sown, the CA, or the government may say that this is good agricultural land, then no future development will ever be allowed by the government. And on the other hand, there's no policy incentive to encourage owners of agricultural land to conserve such agricultural land. So would the government conduct a study or to change the existing policy in case you have rezoned an agricultural land as a CA or you have subsumed it as part of country park? Would you consider changing the policy of no compensation paid to landowner so that you can have an additional tool to the encourage landowners to conserve such land? Yesterday, I asked a question about race. According to the race ordinance, agricultural land in NT is not charged for under the race ordinance if they use the land for agricultural land. That is a farming or a livestock farming. So there's a definition of agricultural use. According to the government, the lands department would inspect these sites, and theoretically, if the sites are now turned into brownfield sites, they are subject to rates. But I try to look up the information from your website, but the information is not available, or and we don't know whether rates are charged or whether exemption or a waiver has been granted. I would like the government to look, the director to look into the law enforcement on land use. They are not paying rates, they are not paying rent, and they use their agricultural land as a brownfield site. Let me answer the first question first. Is there any way to make sure the rural land can be better? Yes, there are some way we can do it. For example, let's look at Shaolodong. Through a land exchange, non-in-situ land exchange arrangement, we can better conserve the land in Shaolodong. But not all sites can be handled like this. I've heard your comments, Mr. Wu. But the zoning, we are not going to pay compensation because of rezoning in the OCP. This is a long-established policy. I can only tell you that the government at present has no intention to change that policy. As for the rates, an assessment of rates by R&B department, we will do our best as long as we can get hold of information. But the rural land utilization and land use there can be very complicated and can change. It's a challenge that we will try to help get hold of information on a timely manner. The next session will start at 5:55.